And welcome back to Let's Play Star Trek Final Unity. We are reading...
Primary core access enabled. Systems online.
We're reading computer entries. And I have a Frappuccino here, which might help with my voice, coating the... whatever, surface of my... inside of my throat or something. I had no idea it was going to be this long. The last episode, I figured might be like 15, 20 minutes, and then we might continue with the mission. It turned out being an hour long, and we only covered the USS Enterprise, which is all of this, and this, and some subsystems, sub-entries, bridge crew, which is actually interesting, a little support craft thingy. Read all that, and sciences, astronomy, we covered. All that. Planets. Different kinds of stars. Some subheadings. Phenomena. Which are many. All the arrows you see are subheadings. It's insane. And a little thing on moons. And now we're up to biology. Now, I'm reading them all because unlike the Mass Effect games, I don't have 100-something episodes to spread this out, so gonna read it all now and just get it over with. Okay, so this is current mission items of biological interest. We've only got space dwellers, space-dwelling life forms. The Federation has encountered many life forms whose habitat is interplanetary or interstellar space. Let me just reset my timer here. These life forms vary greatly in their structure and appearance, and most show no obvious relationship with other space-dwelling forms. A number of space-dwelling life forms are known to be sentient. Current theories are that some space dwellers were artificially created and that others developed near the galactic core, where there is plentiful gas, dust, and energy. The Preservers. There is evidence that species on many planets share common ancestry due to deliberate seeding of worlds by one or more groups of sentient beings and by the transplanting of successful species from their original world to several other worlds. One such group of life-spreading beings active within recent time is called the Preservers, though nothing further is known about them. Do we have a... Next Generation episodes about the Preservers? I don't recall. Archaeology. Kridnar Archaeological Timeline. Before 1 million years ago, miscellaneous unclassified traces, unidentified culture, code E0-522, probable Takan visits, possibly Age of Zora. 1 million to 900,000 years ago, Chodak Empire appears and collapses. 900,000 to 800,000 years ago, Takan Empire rule, possibly Age of Simi. 800,000 to 700,000 years ago, possible origin of Zatarnis Nebula, disputed. Takan leave, reason unknown. 700,000 to 600,000 years ago, Orduriak and Orjoto civilizations. They war to mutual destruction. Takan visits, Age of Makto. 600 to 500,000 years ago, Takan Empire collapses. Probable visit by unidentified, possibly proto-Vulcan race. 500 to 400,000 years ago, widespread destruction by leftover Orduriak Orjoto weapons. This problem continues to the present day. 400,000 to 300,000 years ago, possible Iconian visits, disputed. 300,000 to 100,000 years ago, Iconian civilization collapses. I remember the Iconian. Isn't that the episode where they sent an away team down to a planet that had automated defenses? Kind of what they're saying here. And, something Data had to shut down the computer, and, he was shutting down as well, something like that. Before the whole planet blew up, or something like that. Been a while since I've seen these episodes. 100,000 years ago to present day, miscellaneous unclassified traces, modern activity. Alright, so that's archaeology for you. Technology. Current mission items of technological interest. Spacecraft. Types of spacecraft commonly seen within the Kridnar navigation block. Klingon. Types of Klingon spacecraft sometimes encountered within the current sector. Bird of Prey. Supports a crew of approximately 12. Its main weapon system is an array of disruptors. The ship's engine is a warp drive of Manti-Antimatter configuration. Cruisers. Types of Klingon cruisers sometimes encountered within the current sector. Klingon attack cruiser. Approximately 3/4 of the length of the Enterprise, the Vorcha class attack. Why does that sound familiar? Vorcha is a... Vorcha is the name of a race in another game, Vorcha. Crap, I have to look that up. I'm gonna write that down, Vorcha. I feel like I should know this, and I can't recall. So the Vorcha class attack cruiser is the newest addition to the Klingon fleet. In the forward part of the ship is located a massive disruptor cannon which can be ejected for additional speed. In some ships, the forward cannon has been replaced by hardware specific to the mission. Klingon battle cruiser. Katinga class carries a matter-antimatter engine and a weapons load of disruptors and torpedoes. Vorcha. The Vorcha. That's killing me. The Vorcha. Something from Mass Effect? Vorcha. Oh, frick! The Vorcha, the race of... Yeah! The race that we fight. They're often mercenaries in the Blood Pack, and they live like 10 years, or something like that. Vorcha, duh. Yeah, I should know that. Really not in the Mass Effect mode right now. I immerse myself in games, so I'm like just all about Federation space and stuff right now. Alright, so those are Klingon. Romulan. Types of Romulan spacecraft. Warbird. The Dariex class. Data on the Romulan Dariex class are incomplete. These ships have a cloaking device that can render them invisible to Federation sensors, but the power drain can weaken their systems. Romulan Scout. Federation records on Romulan scout ships do not exist. That's unfortunate for us. Ferengi spacecraft. Ferengi marauders, propelled by matter-antimatter reactors, carry a weapons load of photon torpedoes and an energy wave weapon. And devices. Technological devices of current interest, of which we only have chameleon field. This type of field was first observed being used by an alien probe following the attack that crippled Merton Station. It disguises the object it covers by broadcasting false sensor readings across a wide spectral band. Careful observation may detect a brief flicker of a true reading before it is masked by the false reading. The flicker may be caused by the brief time the field needs to synchronize itself with the sensor's frequencies before it can start returning a false signal. Chameleon field was later discovered to be a device of Chodak origin, and was used by inhabitants of Phrygis to disguise their entire planet from outside detection. Yes, and we encountered the Merton Station at the beginning of this Let's Play. So that's it. Okay, that's it for sciences. Starfleet. Starfleet was created in 2161 to carry out the following duties. 1. Protect Federation space. 2. Provide aid and assistance to members. 3. Gather knowledge. 4. Regulate shipping within the Federation Treaty Zone. And that's it. Starfleet Command is based outside San Francisco, Terra, within the United Federation of Planets complex. Really, they call Earth Terra? And this is more about the Enterprise, which we read in the preceding episode. Not falling for that. Communiques. Transcripts of recent subspace transmissions from Starfleet. Complaint. Subspace radio transmission, complainant, supervisor. Morphology, Institute. Recipient, Admiral Redrick. History. The Doctor is midway through a 4-year tenure at Marassia. She catalogs local species in the Federation Morphology Database. Dr. Hoon Forsch failed to report to her sector supervisor and return and respond to calls. According to Marassian liaison Constable Lixie, that's the funniest name ever, the Doctor had packed for a field trip. Local surveillance systems have received no distress calls related to her absence. Constable Lixie reports no need for further investigation, but will allow a Federation investigatory team onto the surface. Constable Lixie, Preserve Liaison. Assignment, to represent the Preserve and surrounding territories in the Marassian Constabulary Government. To supervise Preserve planning, construction, import, and security. Okay, done with that. So, obviously, they're going to be adding entries as we continue through the game. Every once in a while, I'm going to take a drink. Hope that helps. Marassia is the fourth of six planets. A Class M planet noted for its unusually diverse ecologies, it is ruled by three dominant species. Uklis, Minoi, and Gumtwumhai. All three have a matriarchal system of tribal rule. Representatives of each comprise the Marassian Constabulary Government. Crap. The inhabitants have shared a millennium of peaceful cooperation. Their main achievements are in the natural sciences. Federation petition pending. Of note, under construction is the Marassian Preserve, encompassing three biotopes, environments, and a diverse array of galactic species. With its philosophy that all creatures are kin, the Preserve will be a center of scientific and zoological research. Alright, so Starfleet's done. Cultures. This is going to be interesting. Well, I can't help but notice the Borg there. Some of the major cultures that may be encountered within the current sector. Federation. The United Federation of Planets has many members in the local region. Currently, 128 local sectors are in Federation territory, and 48 are in the Federation Romulan Neutral Zone. Worlds in several non-aligned local sectors are interested in Federation membership or are trading with Federation members. Federation membership. The UFP is a voluntary organization of sovereign worlds. Membership is open to any planet within the Treaty Zone that satisfies the Official Charter of Standards. It must have a global government or coordinating body, a century of global peace, civil rights, technical development above 6, according to the Richter scale of industrialization, and 78% social development according to the Federation scale of ethics. Okay, currently we are missing quite a few of these standards. Unless involved with Federation enemies, non-affiliated systems may engage in interstellar trade with Federation members. That's why I feel the Star Trek universe is, as far as Earth, a little, like, fantastical. I think it's going to take us over 1,000 years to get even close to this. There are currently more than 1,600 members in the UFP. Starfleet, and here we have the same stuff again. Okay. Chodak. Little is known about the Chodak Empire, which seemed to flourish between 1 million and 900,000 years ago. Upon the discovery of a Chodak base at Horse 3, all the sites discovered have been in Romulan space, giving Federation archaeologists little opportunity to make detailed studies. Technology. Some examples of known Chodak technology, of which we only have the chameleon, which I've already read about. Ferengi. Ferengi traders are highly active in the local region. The Ferengi are a humanoid species distinguished by gold-brown skin tones, occipital ridge folds, and pronounced ear structures. The average height measures approximately 5 feet. Ferengi hierarchy is usually determined by wealth. Although a team-oriented culture, subordinates in the group constantly challenge the dominant male. The species generally has a low birth rate and a high rates of genetic mutation. Very little is known of Ferengal, the homeworld of the Ferengi species. No Federation expedition has ever approached Ferengal. And we've already read about the Ferengi marauders. Klingons. Don't skip one, though. The Romulan Klingon border includes several nearby regions, so the presence of Klingon reconnaissance missions in non-aligned local sectors is considered possible. The Klingons are tall, powerfully built humanoids with a distinctive forehead structure. Known as Konos, which I hope I'm pronouncing correctly, the Klingon homeworld is a bluish-green planet. First City is the capital of the planet and of the Klingon Empire. And we've read about their spacecraft. The Romulans. The Romulan Empire is a major presence in this area of space. There are 115 local sectors within the Empire, and 48 local sectors are within the Federation Romulan Neutral Zone. Romulans are a humanoid species distinguished by pointed ears and short black hair. The Romulan Wars between Earth and the Romulan Star Empire lasted from 2156 to 2160. The Battle of Charon concluded the wars and created the neutral zone in the Treaty of Algernon. Before 2364, the last Federation contact occurred during the 2300 Tomed incident, in which thousands of Federation lives were lost. A previous alliance existed with the Klingon Empire but has been dissolved for decades. Romulus is the Federation name for the home planet of the Romulan Star Empire. And we've read about their spacecraft as well. And there's more spacecraft, another entry. Morogo Raiders. The Morogo are believed to be responsible for most of the cargo ship losses in the Kridnar region. There is, as yet, no reliable data on the Morogo or their spacecraft. Now, were they in the show? Because I don't remember that. I'm forgotten a lot, though, I'm sure. Garidians. The Garidians are similar in appearance to and are allied with the Romulans. It has been proposed that the two races are related, and interbreeding has been known to occur, but not enough is known about their respective histories to confirm this hypothesis. Excuse me? The Garidian homeworld is called Garid. Their society is class-oriented, with a small upper class known as the Patricians ruling over the lower plebeian class that far outnumbers them. The world is governed by a ruling council composed entirely of patricians. The military holds great power, but only patricians are allowed to serve as officers. According to the terms of their alliance with the Romulan Empire, the Garidians purchase all their warships from the Romulans. See Romulan spacecraft for more details. We have already done so. And finally, the Borg. The Borg are an ancient cyborg race, particularly organic, partially artificial life. First Federation encounter with the Borg occurred 7,000 light-years beyond explored space. The species operates as a collective consciousness via a complex of interactive frequencies across a subspace domain. Born humanoid, the species implants artificial intelligence devices linked directly to their brains. Subcommands for functions such as defense, communication, and navigation divide their consciousness. The Borg are controlled by a hierarchical command structure that protects against unauthorized control overrides. Their collective strength entails ship and self-control and regeneration. Injured Borg are disconnected by the receiver and self-destruct. Individual life signs cannot be registered by Federation scans. The Borg Collective seeks technological consumption, not wealth or political expansion. They claim to wish to raise the quality of life for species they assimilate. They have annihilated several outposts on both sides of the neutral zone, NJ-25-6. And that's it for cultures. Local area. General information about the area of space in which the Enterprise is currently located. Oh, cool. Zatarnus Nebula, or Zatarnus, is an unusually dense cloud of gas and dust occupying over 3,000 sectors, 143 of which are in the Kridnar navigation block. Visibility inside the nebula is usually only 10 light years or less. Some unknown force within the nebula interferes strongly and erratically with subspace radio and warp drive fields. Several Federation ships and large numbers of survey probes have been lost in the nebula. Romulans and other races also claim to have lost ships there. By treaty, anyone may enter and explore the nebula, but no territorial claims may be made. The nebula is generally avoided by local space-going races, some claiming that it was caused by the Chodak, and others that it is the hiding place of the mythical Star-Eater Beast. Wow. The Kridnar Navigation Block. The Kridnar, a stellar cartographic survey block of 512 sectors, is located just toward the galactic edge from the Zatarnus Nebula. The Kridnar indicates a small part of the Zatarnus, a portion of the Federation-Romulan neutral zone, several Federation-Romulan sectors, and a number of independent and unexplored areas. It is near, but not adjacent to, Klingon Empire territory, where it borders on Romulan space. The Anomalous Zone is a name given to an area of uncertain boundaries in the lower central portion of the Kridnar navigation block. Races with long-term astronomical observations of the area claim that several stars have vanished here over a period of many thousands of years. More recently, many starships have vanished in this area, though none of Federation origin. Let's hope we don't become the first. The ship disappearances have been blamed on the Morogo Raiders, ghosts of the Chodak, a creature that eats stars, and a radiation leakage from the nearby Zatarnus Nebula. What is a Star Eater? The Star Eater is a creature found in the myths of many local races which eat stars. Its appearance varies widely from myth to myth, but it is usually described as a very large animal of one sort or another. These myths are thought to have their origin in the obscuring of stars by the expansion of the Zatarnus Nebula. Kind of reminds me of the foe of sorts, and believe it or not, in the comic I used to read called The Legion of Superheroes, was called the Sun Eater. And yeah, it's basically, if I remember right, it was like an amoeba on fire or something like that. And yeah, it would eat suns and destroy freaking solar systems. Recent nearby space activity verified. Okay, we got normal traffic from Romulan Empire Federation. Trading and piracy from Ferengi. Information treaty from Iridian. Various local warp traffic and sublight traffic. Suspected but unverified Klingon spying. Kridnar political zones. The Kridnar region can be divided into five zones by status under Federation-Romulan treaty agreements. Federation, within the United Federation of Planets. Romulans may not enter without Federation permission. It doesn't seem to stop them very much. Romulan, within the Romulan Empire. Non-Romulans may not enter without Romulan permission. Neutral zone may not be entered or claimed by anyone. Nebula zone may be explored but not claimed by anyone. And non-aligned may join the Federation or the Romulan Empire or remain non-aligned as they choose. May be entered by anyone, but use of force is forbidden. And we've read about the Chodak and the Chameleon. We're making progress here, believe it or not. These subcategories give details related to recent Enterprise missions. Captain's logs pertaining to recent events. Morassia. Arrival. Captain's log, supplemental. I like saying that. The Enterprise has arrived at Morassia to investigate the disappearance of Dr. V. Hun Forsch, an exobiologist stationed here for the past 2 years. The three species native to this world have enjoyed a millennium of peaceful cooperation, and this visit will give us the opportunity to review Morassia's petition for membership in the Federation. Completion. Captain's log, supplemental. Our successful attempt to locate Dr. Hun Forsch has uncovered another mystery. Apparently, the creature responsible for the chaos on Morassia may have come from Romulan space. We are currently searching for the Ferengi trader Aramet. Despite somewhat questionable trading practices, he has never violated Federation law until now. Merton Station. Captain's log. We have arrived at the Simcoe system in response to a distress call regarding Merton's orbital station. The station was apparently attacked by unknown forces, leaving it in danger of a power core breach. Frigis. Captain's log. Supplemental. The Enterprise has arrived at the Shonioso Epsilon system, where, according to Aramet's data, we expected to find the world where the followers settled. However, our sensors show no Class M planets in the system at all. And at completion, we have successfully retrieved the Garidian's fifth scroll, and Tabak has verified the manuscript's authenticity. Lucana assures me the mere existence of the scroll may radically alter the structure of Garidian society. Intercept Unidentified Vessel. Captain's Log, Stardate 47111.1. A Federation listening post along the Romulan neutral zone has detected an unidentified vessel headed for Federation space. The Enterprise is moving to intercept. Garidian Confrontation. Captain's Log, supplemental. A Garidian warbird has violated the neutral zone in pursuit of a small vessel. The vessel's passengers are apparently seeking political asylum from the Federation, but as yet we have been unable to confirm their intentions. And we've read this. Mission logs. Recent away team mission results. Horse 3. You can read all that if you want. Horse 3 is a lifeless world that evoked little interest until a year ago when the first ruins of a Chodak base within Federation territory were discovered there. The Federation Archaeological Survey has sponsored an expedition led by the noted Vulcan archaeologist, Shaynok, to investigate the Chodak site. Simcoe 4. Leader Chancellor Danab. Simcoe, as it is called by its inhabitants, joined the Federation 12 years ago. As a point of pride, the Simconians built the Merton's Orbital Station, where they entered the Federation to show that they consider themselves worthy of joining. Frigis. Chancellor Larac, leader. Settled 1,000 years ago by Garidian disciples of the lawgiver called the Followers, who left Garad to establish their own society. The planet had previously been the site of a Chodak base, with many Chodak artifacts and mechanisms still operational. The Garidian settlers used a Chodak chameleon field to disguise themselves and hide from the outside world. Merton's Orbital Station. A scientific research station with some Federation staffing, specializing in status of power generations, particularly from gravitic sources. Named after Dr. Edwin Merton's father of modern gravitation theory. As a point of pride, the Simconians built the station 12 years ago when they entered the Federation to show that they considered themselves worthy of joining. Construction, 4.8 kilometers long, walls constructed out of an experimental self-sealing material. Highly experimental power core put into operation 5 years ago. Crew complement 583. One serendipitous discovery was a method of gravitic stress analysis for accurately determining the age of objects. This brought Merton Station's secondary fame as an archaeological research facility. Attacked by unknown forces. Station is currently non-operative for an unknown period of time while damage is being assessed. The station's original attackers were not in evidence, but an automated probe has been left behind. After draining much of the station's power, the probe vanished into space, presumably to recontact its creators. The probe possessed an advanced technological enhancement nicknamed a chameleon field. This field somehow broadcasts false readings to normal sensors, leading them to report something other than an accurate description of the object being scanned. Morassia. Population... What? What is that? 2 trillion? No, 2,477,698,000. Divided among three prominent species, Ucles, Minoi, and Gumdumhai. Federation petition pending. Government is a Morassian constabulary government consisting of members from each of the dominant species. The species have shared a millennium of peaceful cooperation. Preserve liaison is Constable Lixie. Each of the three dominant species has a matriarchal system of tribal rule. Morassia's main achievements have been in the natural sciences. Under construction is the Morassian Preserve, encompassing three biotopes or environments and a diverse array of galactic species. With its philosophy that all creatures are kin, the preserve will be a center of scientific and zoological research. Visited by Federation Starship Enterprise in successful search for missing Federation biologist Dr. Hin Forsch, the Enterprise also stopped the illicit smuggling of proscribed species into the preserve, traced to consultant Idia and the Ferengi trader Aramut. Speaking of Aramut, Ferengi trader known to deal in exotic animals. Last reported position was Jower 3. Stuff. Recently found to conspire with Dr. Idia to import unlicensed animals to the preservation complex on Morassia. Aramut reported a rumor that a large portion of the Romulan fleet was being hastily refitted for speed rather than fighting ability. Aramut's shipping records indicating obtaining a creature known as a Soltis reptile from Shonioso Epsilon 6, an M-class planet. This creature, which can absorb energy and is capable of phase shifting, was previously known to be indigenous only to Garrett. Alright, so we've... Oh wait. Tricorder? Wait a second. Where was I? Was I in Tricorder? No. Well, I read all the I read the mission captain's logs. Did I skip this Tricorder? I did. I think. Yeah. Okay. Dr. Hunforsch. Dr. V. Hunforsch. Short-term resident, Federation Exobiologist, Morphology Institute. Excuse me. Duty is enter local species in Federation Morphology Database. Advise preserve caretakers. Customs check. Short-term visitors to Morassia must declare possessions. Missing, backpack gear, 4 field suits, hygiene kit, bioprobe, cryo-stabilizer kit, and field work boots. Surveillance, no distress calls recorded. Fieldwork renders nearly all the doctor's colleagues inaccessible. Last sighting was by Dr. Idia, listed last. Inango. Permanent resident, listener, stuff. Federation Animal Communication Specialist, Visual Communication, discuss preserve animals. Mavit. Oh, cool looking. Tiller A. Mavit. Short-term resident. Federation phytosociologist. Hailing contact. Discuss preserve species in relation to plant community. Healer Zolas. Permanent resident. Euclidean. Neurologist. Visual contact. Discuss preserve in its caretaking. Consultant Idia. A complete jerk. Short-term resident. Federation recommendation. Federation exobiologist. Preserve consultant. Last visual contact. Discuss preserve and nature species. Alright, locate Dr. V. Hun Forsh at the Morassian Preserve. Morassia is a cannibal. Yeah, they're cannibals. Is a candidate for Federation entry. The preserve is managed by Constable Lixie, who opposes Morassia's Federation membership petition. Dr. Hun Forsh is a Federation exobiologist posted to Morassia to catalog new species for the Federation morphology database. She has failed to report in on schedule. Cultural note. Morassian society is strictly matriarchal. Males are second-class citizens at best. They didn't seem to bring that out in the, you know, adventure, did they? That was going to play more of a part and stuff, but you know, it was a minor. Phrygis. Chant. This is how we find it? This is what I was looking for in the tricorder back when I was on the planet. Who knew we have to beam up to the friggin' ship to read it? Well, it probably scrolled off or disappeared when I saved the game and exited or something like that. So, the subject is the futility of wisdom, and it's a translation. The wise man knows how complex is the universe. The wise man knows that to open the gates of knowledge, he must first admit his ignorance. So that's why we answer all the questions to get past the, what do we call it? It wasn't the gates of knowledge, it's, crap. I don't remember. The gates of, the door of illumination, I believe. Yeah, so we have to answer. Door of, you know. The door of enlightenment. That's what it was called. As soon as I write this stuff down to make a note for myself, I remember. So, yeah, all your answers have to be like, I don't really know. I really have no idea. That kind of thing. That kind of thing to get past the door. Interesting. If I had been able to get at this, I would have figured it out. But otherwise, I just kind of did it randomly, and it worked. Either way. Mission objective. Location Phrygis, Shonioso Epsilon 6. Objective to find the original copy of the Garidian Lawgiver's legendary Fifth Scroll. The Lawgiver fled Garrod with a reputed Fifth Scroll which may grant civil rights to Garrod's plebeian classes. The Garidian refugees aboard the Enterprise hope to use this scroll to promote social justice on their homeworld. And we got Mertens. Unknown. Subject unknown. Oh, this is the thing that we found. And this is... It used the chameleon field so that it looks like this. But that's not what it really is. Subject is naturally occurring interplanetary debris. Oh, no, it's not. Energy none. Composition about 39% iron. 28% silicon, 19% water crystalline, 4% unidentifiable compounds, less than 1% each of gold, iridium, hydrogen, sodium compounds, carbon compounds, and lead. Trace amounts, less than 0.1% of many inert elements and compounds. Mass is 126.73 kilograms. I'm wondering if the mass is actually even accurate. Unidentified device. Mass is 15,255 kilograms minimum. Surface is neutronium. Minimal thickness, 5 centimeters. This is the true actual sensor reading. Minimum thickness, 5 centimeters. Deeper scan impossible. Energy, maximum output estimated 9.6 warp equivalents. Duration 10 minutes. Reserves increasing. Emissions, plasma suspension beam, active scanner waves. Warning, evidence of phaser capability. Analysis, subject is warp capable device, origin unknown. Okay, so we're done with missions. Yay! Tactical. Oh boy. Basic tactical maneuvers available to a galaxy-class starship. More complex maneuvers can be built by performing different combinations of the basic maneuvers. We might need to be doing this now that we're technically at war with the Romulans. So we got brake. Brake maneuvers are evasive tactics used when you are being pursued by an opponent. By looping your ship around the opponent, you move out of its line of fire and place yourself in a more advantageous position, usually coming up behind the opponent. The subheadings on the left list the basic looping maneuvers. Hard. I'm not sure what that all means. Hard brake 360. The ship executes a quick 360-degree loop whose radius is approximately 5 ship lengths. This tactic is used when the pursuing vessel is highly maneuverable and close behind. The tight loop, though stressful on the ship's system, places you behind the enemy before it can react. Medium loop 360. Radius is approximately 10 ship lengths. This tactic is used when the pursuing vessel is as maneuverable as your own and not directly on your tail. It is designed to place you behind your pursuer before it can adequately compensate. Large loop 360. Approximately 25 ship lengths. This maneuver is used on a slower, more lumbering opponent or one that is maintaining a large distance to your rear. It places the least strain on your ship while still placing you behind your opponent. An Immelmann twist. It's like Oliver Twist. The ship executes a 180-degree inside loop. The ship banks and then completes another 180-degree loop as an outside loop. This maneuver, named for an early 20th century Earth pilot, allows you to evade pursuit and change direction simultaneously. Drink. Corkscrew maneuvers or barrel rolls are defensive in nature, causing the ship to roll over about an axis, running lengthwise through the center of the ship. This presents a constantly changing aspect to the opponent. Different shields are continually turned towards the enemy, reducing the burden on any single shield. The subheadings on the left list the basic corkscrew maneuvers. We've got C, clockwise corkscrew. The ship executes a fast clockwise barrel roll. The quick roll counters a constant, heavy enemy barrage by spreading any damage evenly around the ship. Counterclockwise corkscrew. The quick roll. Yeah, same. C roll. Clockwise roll. The ship executes a slow clockwise barrel roll. The slower roll counters light or intermittent enemy fire by presenting random sides toward the opponent. Clockwise. Error. Counterclockwise roll, and it says clockwise here. Otherwise the same. So counterclockwise barrel. Clockwise. Yeah, they messed up here. Defensive roll. The ship executes one of the above listed types of barrel roll selected by the ship's computer as determined by the current tactical situation. The selection attempts to confuse the opponent. Jink roll. The ship executes a situation-dependent combination of barrel rolls. The computer selection is intended to prevent predictability and protect weakened shields by keeping them out of the opponent's line of fire. Weapon. Weapon maneuvers are quick strike offensive tactics designed to quickly disable an opponent and bring a quick end to the conflict. The subheadings on the left list some of the standard weapon maneuvers. Hitman. The ship approaches the target directly, fires its weapons, and then spins 180 degrees before rapidly separating from the target. This tactic is intended to overload the opponent's shield at a given point, break through, and disable it with a single stroke. Strafe, or Deadeye Strafe. The ship quickly flies by its target, firing as the separation distance decreases. The ship continues flying past the target until it is a safe distance away. Then it reacquires its target and repeats the maneuver. This tactic is used to overload the opponent's shields at multiple points and cause a general breakdown in its defense. Following. Following maneuvers are used when your ship attempts to chase or capture a fleeing opponent. Tail chase, or tail close. The ship maintains a distance of 1,000 meters from the target. This tactic is recommended when your ship greatly outranks its target in speed and firepower, and can compensate quickly if the target tries a hard evasive break. Chase is the same here, only 2,000 meters instead of 1,000. Shadow. The ship maintains a distance of 4,000 meters from the target. This is a cautious tactic when your target has unknown or greater powers than your own, but you do not want it to escape. Pursuit. The ship cautiously closes the distance between itself and its target to 1,000 meters. This maneuver respects your opponent's offensive capabilities. And high pursuit. The ship closes the distance between itself and its target to 1,000 meters as quickly as possible. This maneuver is appropriate either when your ship's capabilities greatly outrank its targets or when time makes other considerations secondary. Warping. Warping maneuvers allow your ship to break off an engagement when it is threatened. To achieve warp, your combined drive systems, warp and impulse, must be at least 25% charged, your combined reactors must be at least 25%, and your warp drives alone must be at least 25%. If these systems only meet these minimum requirements, the ship can only warp a short distance. To achieve a safe disengagement distance, your warp drives must be at least 70% charged, your warp reactor must be at least 75%, and your combined impulse drives must be at least 60%. Subheadings on the left list the basic warping maneuvers. Regroup, tactical regroup. The ship warps to the far side of the current sector of space. This places a measure of distance between itself and the opponent while still allowing it to monitor the situation. Disengage. The ship warps into an adjacent sector of space. This takes it safely away from the opponent and effectively ends the conflict. Gotta remember that one. Attacking. Attacking maneuvers are designed for long-term conflict. Here are some standard attacking maneuvers. Star maneuver. The ship attacks the target and immediately veers off along one of the target's primary axes. Once the ship has reached a safe distance from the target, it will attack again and retreat once more along another primary axis. Speed star attack. This is similar to the star maneuver, except that the ship travels a shorter distance from the target before it turns for another attack, and its movements are not limited to the target's primary axis. Stalk and full release. The ship closes in behind the target until it is within comfortable firing range, at which point it fires all weapons at once. The ship then peels off quickly to get out of the opponent's firing range until its own weapons are reloaded, at which time it repeats the procedure. Okay, no more submenus in here. Phasers. The chance that phaser fire will hit its target depends on three variables: the size of the target's distance from the phaser beam's source, and its velocity relative to that source. A big target is easier to hit than a small one, duh. A nearby target is easier to hit than a distant one, double duh. And a slow-moving target is easier to hit than a faster one, triple duh. Stationary targets, of course, are the easiest to hit, big duh. A phaser blast delivers a maximum power of 257 megawatts for a full 6-second burst. Okay, I haven't read this. Okay. Photon torpedoes can deliver an effective blast of nearly 875 megajoules, causing devastating damage to unprotected targets. Torpedoes have limited success, however, when they hit a target with strong shield protection. When a torpedo hits the shield of a target ship, the destructive force spreads out across the shield's surface area, thus weakening the intensity at the point of impact. The shield's ability to distribute the torpedo's energy is proportional to the cube root of its surface size. The average power delivered from this type of impact is approximately 25 megawatts. The chance that a torpedo will hit its target depend on several factors. The size of the target... I'm not going to read the duh stuff in parentheses. The velocity of the target, the speed of the torpedo, and the speed at which the target changes its orientation. The quicker a target dodges, the harder it is to hit. Torpedo flight control is based on forward view tracking. The torpedo can only acquire its target if the target is within a 60-degree cone of view. If the target is outside that cone, the torpedo cannot lock onto it. Photon torpedoes deliver their greatest destruction when they successfully penetrate a target's shields and external plating. This type of impact will usually cause catastrophic damage to the target, including the possibility of complete annihilation. Weapon selection. Hold on a second. Correct selection of weapon type is critical during combat. Phasers are most effective when you are close to the target. When used up close, phasers can temporarily or even permanently eliminate the shields of the target ship. Photon torpedoes are best used in a tight spread at an already damaged target. Several torpedoes hitting a defenseless target will usually cripple or destroy it. If the target ship is executing high speed or radical evasive maneuvers, however, a wide-angle torpedo dispersal may catch the target ship. Shields. Shields can absorb phaser energy based on two factors, the proximity of the source of the phaser blast and the phaser impact angle on the shield. For a shield to maintain full integrity in the face of a direct 6-second burst, the shield must be capable of absorbing no less than 247 megawatts of power. Sensors. The percentage of power allocated and available to the sensors directly corresponds to the amount of information you receive when scanning a target ship. If the combined sensor level is less than 15%, the sensors will not function. If it's between 15 and 50%, the combat display in tactical will flicker. If the combined sensor level is between 50 and 90%, sensor readings of a targeted ship will display the damage level of its systems if the Enterprise's sensor level is higher than the targeted ship's facing shield level. Sensors will also provide detailed readings of the targeted ship's shield strengths. If the Enterprise's sensor level is lower than the targeted ship's facing shield level, the sensors will only show the shield strengths of the targeted ship. If the combined sensor level is greater than 90%, all sensor readings will be displayed. Yay! Done with tactical destinations. This section contains destination information for Federation installments in the Kridnar, deep space stations, outposts, and star bases. Oh, really? That's cool. To set one of these places as a warp destination, show the entry and click on Astrogation. I didn't know we could do that. DS station. Oh, deep space stations. Oh, we don't have Deep Space Nine available. Yeah, they're in a far-off sector, aren't they? So this is deep space stations only within the Kridnar block. Okay, so we've got Deep Space Station 220, 633, 175, 6, and 161. I'm not going to bother listing the sectors and reading those aloud. Okay, so that's destination outposts. Information for all Federation outposts within the Kridnar. Excuse me. Outpost 543 on planet Golder Eta 2. Outpost 172 on planet Myborn Beta 2. Outpost 341 on planet Vanima Alpha 2. Outpost 430 on planet Optima Alpha 2. 174 on planet Vavuro Delta 2. Outpost 644 on planet Bonar Epsilon 1. Outpost 435 on planet Rydal Eta 2. And Outpost 146 on planet Zalu Zeta 1. So we can actually get... If I hit Astrogation, right? Yeah, we can warp right to one of these outposts or stations or star bases. Federation star bases, there's only two. Starbase 131 orbiting planet Hastings Alpha 1, and Starbase 45 orbiting planet Gaudel Alpha 2. Cool. That is really handy. I don't have to manually go there, I like that. And finally, the last section here. Analyses. Oh, and it's just a chameleon. We're done. Oh my god, we're done. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next episode where we actually play the game again. And endure. In enduring, go strong.